warriors, welcome to FACE. Good ECB day. And I want to welcome all our viewers at investing.com. Have a great interview today with Carl Hodson Thomas out of Australia. We're covering the globe. I'm live from the left coast outside of San Diego. We have coverage in Europe and Greece and the UK. We have coverage in Arizona to let you know what's happening with the cacti out there, and in Eastern Europe and Slovakia. So we're covering the globe and many instruments. For those of you that have not seen our service, we have multiple patterns in play, which are actionable ideas every day. Grega has a nice lead in the S&Ps. Andre's been on fire, and he's bottom picking with a harmonic formation here in the Aussie. And Stelios is a macro guy who has the discipline to hold positions for almost like a stock guy, a position trader. And in fact, our guest today, which shows you don't have to trade a lot to be successful, has only 6 to 12 ideas per year that he provides for his subscribers. So a lot of people have 6 to 12 trades a day. You know, whatever suits your personality is what Jack Schwager said when I interviewed him. You find what suits your personality. Someone could be a day trader, scalper, swing trader, position trader. And all of our research is going to help you on our traffic light page. There's a multitude of research that's provided here at ForexAnalytix.com and a multitude of methods. Okay, the methods being basic technical being one of them. Okay, and we also have an expert award-winning Elliott Wave guy, Grega Horvat. Again, here's Andre with his harmonics. Blake and Steve do candlestick work. That should give you an edge. And again, our macro work by Stelios Kantos. So here we are on ECB day. Let's take a look at a few of the markets. Hope everyone's doing okay today. My volume okay? Give me a why if you guys could hear me okay. Katrina's saying you can't. Okay, great. So the S&Ps here, you know, you had great earnings coming out of Facebook. Surprised a lot of people after a nuclear bomb hit Facebook with the Cambridge Analytics scandal. And yet the S&Ps are up, you know, 5-6 handles, nothing that impressive. If you look at this low and you look at this low, those are two drives. We could still see 2,600 in the S&Ps. That's a target that Grega has, about 2,590, I believe. So there could be some left there on the downside. I may sound like a broken record, but I think Aussie Kiwi is peaking here. To confirm it, you need 106.70. This was one heck of a move. Almost got to the full objective up here. I made the tough money in here and have been looking for a correction for about a week now. When it begins, I think 106 is doable, because 106.70 is going to be a negative signal when it's taken out. The high was about 30s, so just arithmetically 60 pips from would take it down to the 50% level at about the big round number of 106, and then maybe we get another wave like we've had here back to 108 or better. Stelios looking for higher numbers. The dollar was coming off a little bit in front of Draghi. I'm going to let Blake cover and give his thoughts on the ECB. So the dollar was taking a breather. I don't believe this dollar rally is over. We still think there's at least 92 in it. Some of the guys I follow think we could see 93, 94. So the dollar, Blake showed a long time ago, broke out, have to respect it. And I would say look to buy pullbacks in the dollar, maybe back to these previous highs around 90, 60. Never chase markets. Let them come to you. And you know what? If you miss it, that's okay. You know why? You're going to miss trades every day. I miss trades every day. And it's okay, because you know what? There's always another trade, always another setup. And I love to use the analogy. Our guest is from Australia. I live in California. and I've tried to surf unsuccessfully, but I watch the great surfers out there, and the real good guys do not try and catch every wave. It's kind of like trading. They wait for the right setup for their best ride. So patience is important, and being patient with yourself. You can't learn experience. It only happens with the passing of time. In our industry, that would be screen time. So be patient with yourself and use less leverage and let your trades breathe. So we're looking at oil. A lot of fear about us in the U.S. pulling out the Iran nuclear deal. Oil's really resisted a strong dollar over the last few weeks. Perhaps Steve will fill us in. I think he has targets up around the 70 level. 75 looks pretty doable, but we're starting to diverge. If you notice here on the daily, this was a confirmed high, and we're not confirming here right now. It's a non-confirmation. Maybe this is drive one and drive two. I would not chase crude here, even on the lower time frames. I think maybe one more high. This could be a one. This was a confirmed high, so I'm looking for new highs on the move. I teach that markets rarely peak when momentum is confirming price, and that's what we had. This looks correct, a little ABC and new high. But I think we're getting close to where we might have some type of decent pullback for better entries. Again, don't chase the oil here, and be patient about top picking it. So with that being said, Blake, what's your take on the ECB message? And I know Draghi usually has a press conference. Don't believe that's begun yet. So how are you today?
Good, Dale, and good morning, and happy morning. ECB day to you. I mean, the euro is trading heavy. I mean, we traded right back down to support this morning, and you can see. Let me just. I have to move a screen over here really quick. Give me a second. Okay, so you can see the euro actually traded down towards support here. This 21.50 is a big deal. I mean, obviously, it's being protected pretty aggressively. This is a 5-minute chart, but you can see how we came down to the 121.50 and we bounced. As everybody knows, that this is just a really big barrier of support. It is what everybody considers the range lows. It's a spike low from right here back in March 1st. And so it's a big deal. Now, as far as the ECB, I mean, this has been the expectations for the ECB have been pretty low today. There's not huge expectations of the ECB. The dovish bar has been set pretty high, but the ECB is expected to talk about extending. Remain the interest rate levels to remain in an extended period well past the horizon of their net asset purchases is one key component. The next component is going to be talking about inflation, and we're expected that the ECB is going to say that they're going to keep the pace of a monthly pace of 30 billion, and they expect that to run to the end of September or beyond if necessary, and until they see a sustained adjustment in the path of inflation consistent with their inflation targets. And then lastly, they're going to talk about reinvestment of principal payments from maturing securities purchases. And talk about that extended period of time after the end of its net asset purchases, and see if they reiterate for as long as necessary. So, between inflation persistently low, they want to make sure that inflation continues to move higher. They want to the market's looking for them to tell us that they're going to keep interest rates at present levels for an extended period of time, and continue to reinvest principal for as long as is necessary. And so the bar, you know, like I said, it's pretty low for a dovish ECB. So we're not really
like when you have a second, you know, Draghi wasn't happy with a 125 euro. Okay. And we're sitting right here at major support. I believe, and I did some research, he would love to see the euro break down, wouldn't he? And the market being in, a vulnerable position, this is his opportunity to create a breakdown in the euro.
Yeah, one of the things that if you take a step back and you look at eurozone growth versus U.S. growth, U.S. growth has been extremely strong, and eurozone growth has not. And one way that the ECB can help finesse that, if you will, is to engineer a weaker currency for their export driven, you know, main economies. Like Germany and France to a lesser extent, but that weaker euro would obviously help with a lot of the tourism of some of the other periphery type of countries as well. So having a weaker euro would be in the best interest of the ECB. Now, you know, I know we haven't heard the terminology trade war for quite some time, but one thing that the U.S. has done over the last year is really engineered a weak dollar. I mean, if you look at the dollar, which we have dropped, you know, basically 10% in the last year. You know, now it's obviously recovering back up towards, you know, 91, but you know, this is going to be a push and pull between, you know, different economies and central banks, and I think Mario Draghi would be very happy if the euro was trading back at one or sub 120, you know, maybe closer to 118. But he's, you know, that may be in Europe's best interest, but the ECB is not obviously going to talk about that directly. But one of the things that we think about is that, you know, the euro positioning is still pretty long from a speculative interest. There's been a lot of reports that I've read that real money is tapered back a lot of their position sizing in the euro, so it's more neutral as far as real money goes. And then, you know, fast money, you know, like hedge funds and you know, like CTAs, they're pretty neutral at the moment. They know that we're range bound. So I think to get the ball moving, you really got to break below this 120, 150. And then more importantly, actually, I think is this number right here is the 120.80 level. This is where people really start to get freaked out as far as, you know, looking for, you know, a lot stronger downside. It would be below 120.80 or 120.90. And I think this is going to be this, yeah, let me draw it out for you. This area right through here is going to be probably like a trap door. Okay, you know, this will be like a trap door here, but it again, you know, how far are we going to go if we break through here? I mean, this is where the test of the, you know, 120.90 becomes extremely important. You know, even if this downside is broken, you know, how much downside that we have. I don't think you're going to get a lot of fast money really pressing the euro lower unless we start cracking below 120.80. Now, I ultimately think that is where we're going. I think that it's just a matter of time before we break down. The reason why I feel that way is because the dollar index has broken this year-long trend line. And it's been stubbornly bid, okay? Stubbornly bid. If you look at the dollar against every other currency, I mean, minus the cable. The cable's holding up fairly well, but still, if you look at the cable, big double top we've got here, the pound, you know, looks like we're eventually going to be dropping to the mid 130s, you know. And if the euro ends up being weaker than the pound, where does that take the euro? Does it take the euro to 118, 116? It's entirely possible. You've got the Aussie that the Aussie, by the way, is below a big weekly trend line here, and it's just consolidating below. It looks pretty weak. The Kiwi is broken down. We got a nice little, you know, double top, triple top, whatever you want to call it. We're making our way lower in the Kiwi. The Canadian, you know, this is a weekly chart, by the way. The Canadian, I mean, it looks bullish. But, you know, obviously between the Canadian and the Mexican peso, it's surrounded by, you know, NAFTA news. So you got to be a little bit more careful. And by the way, I got asked this question yesterday, and let me go ahead and face it right now with all of you guys and gals here. I have for years, I'm talking for 10 years, I've always looked at the dollar Canadian as more of a leading currency pair in respect to the dollar index. So if I see the dollar Canadian and the dollar Swedish krona, by the way, and I'll talk about that here in a moment, those currencies, they tend to lead the dollar index for the most part, and they have for years. I mean, that's something that I've always, you know, always paid attention to. However, I got asked this question yesterday multiple times, actually, several times. And, you know, people were like, hey, you know, the dollar Canadian is weakening. Is that telling us anything about the dollar? You know, meaning the euro might bounce. And my answer to that question is no, not right now, because the Canadian and the peso are really, you can see they're moving hand in hand with, and you can see the peso's reversal, very similar to the Canadian yesterday. They're moving hand in hand based on NAFTA negotiations. So they're I kind of dismiss what the Canadian's doing right now. Once we get past the NAFTA negotiations and, you know, renegotiations, and, you know, we have some new NAFTA agreement in place, then I'll start looking at the Canadian again more as a, you know, maybe lead indicator to what, to how I'm feeling about the dollar. But anyway, so I'm going to go back to the Swedish krona, but let me get to the Swissies. So the Swissies we talk about the hard money, or you talked about making the hard money. I made the hard money right here, right through there, and that's it. And I've watched this train just take off. And the thing about the Swissy, and I'll be the first to admit, that's very poor trading on my point. I took a, you know, quick move above the 200-day moving average, made a quick little profit, and then I should have just stuck with it. I mean, you can see the Swissy has just taken off. Now, obviously, we're extremely overbought right now, and we're running into a downtrend line, and the 78% retracement makes me a little nervous being long the Swissy right at this moment or establishing new positions. If I was short, I'd be a little concerned because, you know, we could continue to break higher. And one of the things about the Swissy is, you know, the borrowing costs of buying Swiss francs is ridiculous with negative interest rates. So this unwind of these positions makes a lot of sense to me on why it's doing it. I can't chase it here. I mean, we could obviously continue to go higher. And if I was short, I'd be probably a little concerned, especially knowing that the euro is within pips of really starting to break down. So anyway, the Swissy is ripping, but take a look at the Swedish krona. We had a dovish Riksbank last night. You can see how the spike higher in the US dollar Swedish krona, it's tapered off. I actually bought some this morning at my cost average is 857.58. So right here is where I own it. And the US dollar Swedish krona, I mean, this thing is really bullish for a lot of reasons. Not only is it inverse to the euro, but we had this false breakdown over here. Now you have a double bottom V-shaped recovery. It looks like we're going to nine, back to nine on the exchange rate, or maybe 880, 885. I mean, so if the euro breaks down, this is where you've got to start looking for the dollar squeeze, because it's already happening. It's already taking place. Let me get rid of that. It's already taking place here in the US dollar Swedish krona. Let me.
You know, Blake, when you think about it, as bearish as it might be near term here in the euro, that it could go to 118, 117. When you think about it, big picture with 103 low, 125 high, that'd be about 38% back from last year's rally.
Yeah, so you're right. I mean, if you go from these lows to the highs here, I mean, you know, having a move down to 117, yeah, it is only a 38% retracement. I mean, 24% retracement takes us down to 120. So, and that's a, I mean,
it's not necessarily the end of the bear market and the dollar.
No, hell no. And I'm far from believing that. I actually think the dollar is going lower longer term, you know, but to see the euro do this, realistic in the realm of possibilities. I would be a buyer of the euro on a severe dip. If we can get it down, you know, towards like this breakout point around 117, I'd be very happy to be on the long side down here, because what you do, and let me draw this out for you really quick. Let me get a better pen color, which
Where I'd want to buy the metals as well. If that happens, that should pressure the gold under 1300 and maybe silver under, you know, at 1550 or lower. So,
yeah,
you know,
sure.
Well, I mean, maybe even crude will pull back 20 cents.
So if you look at the euro, like from, you know, higher low standpoint, I mean, here's where we are at. I mean, here's where we're at right now. But to drop down to like one, let's just say like 117, you're still making higher highs, you know, higher lows. So, you know, eventually, you know, breaking higher is what my view would be in the euro dollar eventually. I just think that we're going to get a shakeout of these longs. I can't forget like this conversation I had with the CTA. He's a young guy, probably one of the most knowledgeable in interest rates guy out of London that I've, and him and I chat on Bloomberg every once in a while, like on Bloomberg chat. But we've been following each other on Twitter for a few years. He is probably one of the sharpest young minds that I've met in a long time. And he, you know, reached out to me. We were about right here around 123.50. It's the very beginning of the year. And we had this long discussion and he's like, look, I just came back from this conference. And he goes, there is not one person that is bearish the euro. Everybody's bullish. Every institution is got FOMO. They expect the euro is going to be trading at 130, blah, 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 blah. He goes, it's making me really, really nervous. And we talked about this at length. And, I'm like, yeah, it's a disaster waiting to happen. And yet you think about the beginning of the year. I mean, we're in April right now, but you think about in January, February, and how bullish everybody was coming back from the beginning of the year. This is like the big trade of 2018 is everybody's going to be long the euro. The dollar is going to hell in a handbasket, and we're going to just, you know, just continue to rip higher, and dollar's going to, you know, just collapse, and Donald Trump's going to, you know, demolish the dollar, blah, blah, blah. These FOMO institutions that got in the mid 120s, they're finding themselves fairly wrong footed in this portfolio that they have of long euro exposure. So I believe that a lot of these institutional clients are going to, you know, really be shaken out a little bit, and we're going to see some, you know, momentum traders, the fast money type of traders, jump on board, and you know, the euro could come back down to the 200-day moving average, maybe slightly below, really, you know, shake out some people before regaining its composure. Because, like I said, I do believe that the euro is eventually going higher. I believe we are eventually going to 130. I just, you know, think we could see the teens first, like, you know, 119, 118. Before making that happen, that's why I'm you know, leaning on the euro right now, myself personally, or buying the dollar. Like I said, I'm not a dollar bull longer term. I just happen to have been one for the last month. And everybody's, if you've listened to the week ahead videos that we publish every Sunday for the last month and a half, you know, I've been positioning myself with long dollar positions the whole time, and minus the dollar yen. By the way, I got run over by the dollar yen this week. I shorted it right through here, and I got, you know, blasted in it yesterday or the night before or whatever. I got stopped out. I, you know, I had to take the trade because that was, you know, my setup that I've been looking for. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. other than I took a loss. But looking at the euro dollar, I'm still expecting lower prices. Now, there's one last thing that I wanted to mention before I turn everything over to Steve and Stelios. Or I don't know if Stelios is going to be here. Actually, I don't think he's going to be here. I think it's just going to be just Steve.
He's going to be with us.
I'm here, guys.
Oh, you are? Okay. Okay. Well, hey, guys, real quick. Hold on. That's the ECB. Can you hear the music? That's the ECB hold music. Stand by. Okay. I had to turn that down. That's before Joggy starts speaking. Okay. Yes. It sounds like I'm in an elevator right now. Now we're going to be connected to the conference. Okay, so. Okay.
Stelios is doing the interview today.
Okay, so Stelios, oh yeah, you have your friend that's attending. That's great. That's awesome. It's going to be a great interview, guys. I'm excited to. I'm going to have to listen to the recording because I'm not going to be able to listen to the live, but I can't wait to hear today's interview. And Stelios, you're going to have to tell me all about them. Okay, one last thing I want to talk about is we are expected today. The goods trade balance, which this number, if you guys haven't seen our trade balance numbers just getting demolished over the last few months, you know, analysts are expecting a turn here. And if we start to see a turn in the goods trade balance following some of the storms of last of the fall, this is why we were expected this to recover. That could feed into GDP, which is pretty important going into our advanced GDP on Friday. So I actually think that this number might actually be more important than the ECB number today. So pay close attention to the good trades balance number that comes out here in the next 3 minutes. But with that being said, I got to pass it over to my colleagues, Steve and Stelios, and obviously Dale. Guys, gentlemen, it's all yours for live analysis of the ECB. So, but make sure you pay attention to that trade number.
Good hunting, Blake.
Hey, Blake. Have a good day, mate.
Thank you, Steve. And thank you, Stelios and Dale. And have a great interview. I'm excited to listen to the recording. If you guys don't know how to listen to those, the best thing to do is go to YouTube to our channel and subscribe. And then this way you'll get, I can go back and listen to any of the recordings when they're published, which is just a few hours from now. So thank you, guys. Have a great day.
You do, mate. You do.
Hello, Steve's, plural.
if you want to be exact, hello, Stelios is plural.
Oh, yes. I won't Americanize you. Hello. How are you guys?
Good, mate, good. We're looking forward to seeing what Drag is going to throw at us today.
Yeah, I mean, he's in a position to, why not throw on as much ammo as possible if you want a weaker euro? When it's at a decision point, try and make it happen. Remember, the market kept running over him on the way up to 125. Now he's got a chance to make it happen.
Absolutely. And from a technical perspective, as Blake mentioned it, indirectly and directly, from a technical perspective, I think we are at a good point that if Draghi manages to, to shift the market a little bit, and sound more dovish than expected, then we can have some technical breaks both for the DXY and for the Euro USD, which is definitely going to help start unraveling some of the one-sided positioning. We've seen that the COTs have been hitting like record highs in Euro positions for the vast majority of the past weeks. So for sure, there is a potential to start something, like a bigger correction lower. But Draghi has to deliver today. If he doesn't, and if the market actually manages, if Euro manages to hold above some of the key levels here, for example, if it manages to hold the 121 area that was the high of September 2017, and then we retested this as a resistance before managing to break above it, or the 120.50 area. So I think this 120.50 to 121 area, it's quite important support. It's also the 50% FIB of the last leg higher. The 200 DMA is also moving towards that area. I mean, it's converging there slowly but surely. So I think that
Steve, we just had the number. Sorry to interrupt. Core durable goods worse than expected. Trade balance better than expected, surprisingly. And jobless claims also slightly better than expected. So
initial jobless claims 209k versus 230, right? Yeah, dollar doesn't seem to be doing much, and I think the reason it isn't doing much is because everybody's waiting for Draghi. I don't think anybody's is going to commit due to these new positions. You know, just a few minutes before Draghi starts speaking. Draghi should start speaking, by the way, any minute now. I mean, press conference theoretically speaking starts as we speak. We're seeing a little bit of a rebound today from the cable. It's bound to do something like that. I mean, it was a very strong move to the downside, and definitely such a move to the downside has a high chance of producing at least one more leg lower. So I do think that despite not having proven that we found some long-term high here at the confluence of the ascending trend line resistance in the 78.6 that we got rejected, somebody can also claim that this will end up being a double top, but you know, we haven't confirmed yet. By the way, now dollar seems to be weakening a little bit, still, at least cable seems to be appreciating a little bit more. It's at the highs of the day, so I do think that, you know, even if this is another correction lower, we still might find resistance anywhere between 141. I think 141 is a good resistance area. If we also see the 4-hour chart, let me bring it here. So if you also see the 4-hour chart, I think that interesting resistance areas are the 141 area, also the 141.70, and ultimately I think it's 140-240. I mean, I wouldn't want to see a move above 140-240 and still expect a move to the downside, right? So I do think that a rebound from here can extend somewhat, but you know, given the nature of the move lower, I would expect another move to the downside. I also don't find it impossible to even a reverse from here produce one more low, marginal low, before seeing that rebound happen, right? We seem to be breaking above as we speak. I mean, the RSI divergence was quite clear on the 4-hour chart, so I do think that either today or within the next couple of days, we should see a rebound for the cable. But as I said, I do think that that rebound should initially fail for at least one more leg to the downside, even if this proves to be just a corrective move to the downside, and then we have upside continuation. By the way, Stelio, you can intervene whenever you're ready, whenever Draghi says something of importance. Yep. I see that he's about to start speaking. Yeah, I have Bloomberg unmuted, so I see he's about to start speaking.
Yes, and one note on Draghi from my part is that he has a very good excuse, let's say, to be dovish. You know, Eurozone inflation is low. It's printed 1.3% last time, actually down from 1.4, if I recall. So it's not really doing much at the moment. So that's something he can use. And also, let's not forget that the Italian elections were a few weeks ago. Everybody's forgotten about that, but there's still the issue of, you know, what.
Yeah, we don't have a stable government there. Yeah, absolutely. Exactly. Absolutely.
And the way things look, the most probable government to be formed is an alliance between the Five Star Movement and the Lega Nord, the far right party. So that's really not the most stable predictable government.
And to be honest, during the past few years, we haven't seen governments that had the potential of being stable be stable in Italy. I mean, they've been changing government and prime ministers like like t-shirts,
so like Greece.
so to be honest, yeah, we can't have any real high hopes or expectations that such a government would survive for long, so I'm in total agreement with you. Speaking about Draghi and the ECB, before we actually start seeing some movement here in the euro, don't forget that if Draghi proves to be dovish, that might actually help risk appetite in general, because you know the markets obviously still love money easing and asset purchases, etc. So, you know, if Draghi hints or signals that, you know, the ECB is going to keep having looser monetary policy than at least expected, I think that, you know, that should benefit risk assets as well. Speaking about that very briefly, yesterday, it was one more time that the market tested the 200 EMA, and you know, you can also see it as a triangle support, and got a nice rebound from there. Actually, the day, instead of closing negative as it was showing that it would, turned around, and you know, we got a daily hammer. That's usually
may I interrupt very quickly. Two things is the Draghi said already, and it's the euro is going down slightly.
QE to run until sustained inflation adjustment. That's very dovish
exactly,
message.
Exactly. Yeah. That, and also that there is no set fixed end date for that. So it's kind of you know, it's going to keep going until we really have sustained inflation pickup, which is not visible at the moment. And as long as it takes until that happens.
On the other hand, though, I have to say he just said data points toward moderation of expansion.
Yes, but also another headline I'm just seeing is underlying inflation lacks convincing upward trend, which is what we're saying as well.
So yes.
The euro is not doing anything actually. It's going.
No, the euro isn't doing anything yet, but for sure these are dovish messages. There's no question about it. I mean, it's going to be really bad for Draghi if the market actually dismisses these kind of messages, because if the market fails to produce continuation to the downside, since Draghi is obviously trying to accomplish that, I think that then the DXY's rebound is going to be in danger of failing once again. We were just yesterday saying here that the rebound in the DXY seems nice and promising so far, but to be perfectly honest, and we did close above the 91 area, which is, you know, a strong area of resistance, but we have confluences of resistances coming from 91.70 to 92.50, and only like a decisive move above these multiple resistance levels. I mean, the 200 EMA is at 92, the 50% FIB of the last move higher is at 91.71. We have the 23.6 from the high that we saw in the DXY last year come at 91.93. So, you know, multiple areas of resistances here, and we can even interpret this move higher as a corrective move.
We are getting non-confirmations on the 1 hour and 4 hour time frames in the euro at new lows. Just a warning if you're short the euro that there could be a pop here, okay? And Steve, if you would take a look at euro pound, you know,
absolutely,
it's a pretty big break.
Yeah, it hasn't lowered. Yeah, it's turned lower once again. Yeah.
But we're putting in higher, we could put in higher lows here. And I'm kind of thinking, I was talking about it with Lydia yesterday, that this could be a right shoulder down here, that we had a fall.
Yeah, of an inverted head and shoulder formation. Yeah, right.
So I just wanted to make our community aware of it. Okay, so there could be, you know, if you want to play a bounce in the euro, one of the safer ways to go with lower beta might be euro pound longs, and the euro's making new lows without the euro pound making new lows, which is a divergence in itself.
Yes, that is correct. And regardless, as long as the euro pound is holding this channel, really anything can happen. I mean, you know, from a technical perspective, I was really looking, and I'm still looking at the potential of finally breaking down below this channel and pushing down towards the 83 area. That would be my ideal technical scenario. But, you know, this is a very, very prolonged, we can even call it a consolidation, because the channel is very slightly downsloping. So anything can happen from here.
Yeah, I think short term, the bears missed that opportunity to break it.
Yeah, that's true. It was another attempt that was failed. Yeah. It was another failed attempt to actually manage to break it lower.
Just to interrupt, Steve, Draghi is actually speaking on both sides now. I mean, he was double.
Expect economic growth to remain solid. Yeah, I saw it. Expect.
So
the
euro is ticking up a little bit, like up 15, 20 ticks.
Yeah, Dimitra is right, tell her. It's exactly as he says. why don't you bring her?
Your daughter's in love with the Euro here, Stel.
As it seems, yeah, they're pretty enthusiastic about it. growth risks, Draghi says, though, that growth risks relate to global factors. We knew that. Protectionism risks have become more prominent. It's exactly the same message we've also seen from the Fed. So, you know, there's no surprise there. To be honest, you know, the euro is still holding. I mean, it obviously hasn't popped here in any case. And, you know, there is even the potential. I do think we were discussing earlier in the chat room that there might be several orders waiting perhaps for euro to pop a little bit higher towards these lows here at 122.40, 122.50, even 122.30, perhaps even a retest, because if this proves to be like a triangle, we might even come up a little bit, retest this triangle, and then resume to the downside. So, you know, keep that in mind. I would really want to...
Hell of a one-hour candle here, Steve. And, you know, we alerted people about 30 pips ago, and it was only, you know, 2 minutes ago. So
yeah, it's already an outside white candle here. I took us down to the one-hour chart, as you mentioned. Yeah. So, yeah, it's already an outside white candle. But as I said, in my opinion, we need to see a break above 122.50 to actually start thinking that this is the end of the move lower. And keep in mind, if you remember, Dale, I was saying yesterday very clearly that I have no confirmation that the euro is breaking lower. I know that people have started jumping the gun, but I have no reason to believe so, because, you know, triangle was one possible interpretation. Somebody can even clone this and say, okay, this might have been a downward channel, in which case we didn't break lower, or, you know, any kind of a formation. One thing is for sure, that so far the move we've seen from the highs hasn't had any impulsive characteristics of the downside, right? So in all honesty, that's why I was staying away from getting committed with dollar, because in all honesty, I would still not be surprised if we actually pushed higher once again, right? Perhaps for a terminal push towards the 126, 127 area, but it wouldn't come as a surprise. I mean, price action would definitely indicate that this is still a high possibility. And euro is still recovering. I mean, we're about to test the 122 area once again. Of course, the day is still young, so I think we need to remain a little bit patient. But as I have been saying during the past couple of weeks, I think that it's rather better to wait for more confirmation about this move of the dollar in general than find ourselves committing in positions at you know, the worst possible levels. Definitely, this week's weekly closes are going to be of importance, and I have to say that so far, commodity currencies seem to be doing a lot worse against the dollar than, for example, the euro or even the cable during the past few days. Cable,
and so far, although the dollar's coming off, very muted response in the precious metals.
Yes. So let's have a look at them also here. Here's silver, holding more or less for today in the middle of a long-term consolidation. As we said, unfortunately, silver and gold require us to remain patient. Gold, once again, is more or less in the middle of this triangle. So, you know, we need to remain patient.
1300 stops, man.
Might happen.
You know, they could flush it to your 200-day moving average and take out every long before the turn.
Yeah, because, you know, this is a level of multiple supports. I mean, this is already at least a triple confluence of supports, because it is the 200 DMA, the 50% FIB of the last move higher. It is the low, the intraday low that we saw while we were trading in the triangle. We like intraday broke below it. We tested the 1300 area before rebounding from there. It's also a longer term horizontal support resistance area, and it's also a psychological level since it's a round number. So definitely 1300 will be a huge level, and yeah, they might hunt it down, and actually they might they might take out stops. I mean, it wouldn't be the first or the last time we're going to be seeing that. There's no question.
No, you know, Mr. Market is a real mean guy, and it shakes out as many participants as possible before the move they're looking for occurs, then most likely without them.
For sure. By the way, crude, I saw you mention it at the beginning.
Yeah.
In my opinion, Dale, crude is likely in a short-term consolidation once again. That has likely bullish implications. This might be a triangle, for example, or a flag. I see it very likely that we're going to be pushing higher once again towards my final target at the 161.8 at 72, because the short-term structure here definitely doesn't look bearish yet, right? So I think we might get the opportunity to some better levels to short that. So you know, just with
one more thing that Draghi said a couple of minutes ago. He expects headline inflation to be at 1.5% for the rest of the year. So that's a little bit hawkish. So overall, my gut feeling is that the market probably expects him to be a little bit more dovish than he was. And that's why I think the euro is probably going to squeezing a little bit. It's only a little bit, but it feels like the market thought that he's going to come out all guns blazing and being quite negative, and he hasn't. So he's been quite balanced, actually, with the last few comments that he said. Just my view.
To push euro lower from here, because people have started getting scared that perhaps the move lower in the dollar has already been overdone. So he had the technical opportunity to give it a push, but as it seems, you know, he's refraining from doing so. I mean, he has sent some dovish messages, but as you said, he could have pushed the pedal to the metal even further, right? So as I said, we are seeing a little bit of a pop, but in my opinion, we need to clear 122.50 to the upside, 122.40 to 122.50, to then feel more comfortable that we might have found even a low and are headed higher. So, you know, I don't think that we yet have confirmation of like a continuation to the upside, but definitely the fact that we're not breaking lower is a first sign, right? Let's have a look at the DXY. Intraday, we're seeing a bearish candle, but still it's contained. I mean, it's an inside candle to yesterday's move higher. From a technical perspective, there is even the possibility that even if the dollar wants to keep pushing to the upside, there is even the possibility that we can come down, retest this intermittent here trend line, and then make another attempt to push to the upside towards the 92 area. That would still, though, not be enough for me to confirm that the dollar is breaking higher, because as I said, multiple resistances at around 92. I think that only once we break above there, the market is going to start really getting squeezed, in which case we might see, given this prolonged downtrend, we might see a very big squeeze. I mean, it wouldn't surprise me if we actually manage to clear the 92.50 areas. It wouldn't surprise me to see the dollar trade up back at 96.50 in a rather short period of time, because we know very well that corrections after prolonged moves can actually end up being quite brutal.
Lost you, Steve. Something
yeah.
with your headset.
Momentum and structure. Right. Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, good. Thanks. Okay, I just increased my mic sensitivity. Let's see if that does the trick. So I said that Draghi just said that they have no specific strategy to cut corporate bond purchases. Probably that, not probably, this is being interpreted as a dovish message from the market. Loss of momentum is broad across country sectors. So now Draghi is sending some more dovish messages once again. But, you know, still not much from the euro side. Okay, I think that, you know, we will keep monitoring from this point on, and we can go through seeing a few of the questions and see. Stelio, you can feel free to interrupt me at any given point if Draghi says anything more that is of interest, okay?
Of course, sir.
Okay, by the way, Euro USD, an outside white candle on the 4-hour chart as well. So yes. So far, with some nice RSI divergence. I mean,
right. All I have to say is use less leverage when you're trading Draghi. Use wider stops so you don't get picked off. If you don't use less leverage during a Draghi press conference, your account could be dead.
That's a very good point. One more euro pair I wanted us to have a look at, because it's still quite interesting. That's the euro yen. The euro yen actually is showing a structure that potentially is a descending an ascending wedge, which might break to the downside and see at least one more test of the 129 area. But for us to get confirmation, but for us to get confirmation, we really need to see this break, right? So I'm monitoring it as a potential trade, but there is still no confirmation here. So I need to stress that out. Okay. On the other hand, I know that Blake had a fast look at it, but I wanted to show in the USD Swiss. I wanted to show that the USD Swiss is hitting triple confluence of resistances today once again, because this is an area. Let me zoom out so you can see it. This is an area that we find the descending trend line resistance that passes from the previous two highs. It's also a horizontal area of support resistance. It's also the 78.6 of the last move lower. And you know, all these more or less confluence at the 98.50 to 98.60 area. So we barely touched it today. If you also take into account the fact that we've had 7 consecutive days to the upside, and RSI hit like 77, 78, something like that, the daily RSI, I think that this is a nice level to at least see a short-term pullback. So you know, it wouldn't really surprise me to see a move lower from here, and that. Before attempting to move higher. So even if it's a corrective move, it wouldn't really surprise me to see it come from here. And, you know, we could monitor several potential levels to find a support if that actually proves to be the case. One of them would be this support resistance area at 97.70. Then it would be the ascending channel support. But ultimately, in my opinion, the bull bear line, because definitely after the previous move, I mean, you should be looking for more upside here, would be this area here, these highs at 96.50, the 200 DMA is also there. So I think that even if USD Swiss moves down to that area, you know, it would still remain constructive, and probably that would also be a great area for somebody to attempt to be long. Okay, I mean. Probably I would go. Consider it as a gift, unless it starts getting destroyed, potentially happen. Now, is there a chance that we're going to see a pullback in the USD Swiss and Euro USD, just a pullback in Euro USD, keep pushing to new highs? Yes, there is a chance. And why is that? Because there is a chance that the Euro Swiss is going to break the 120 area. And actually, because, you know, the pullback from the 120 area has been very, very muted. And, you know, this looks bullish to me, the fact that we didn't see a bigger pullback from this key area of support. So if we actually see the 120 area break, I think that we might see some acceleration to the upside for the Euro Swiss. So keep that in mind, because a confirmed break above 120 will definitely help USD Swiss keep most of its gains, even if the Euro USD resumes a move to the upside. So this is something to pay attention to for sure. Euro USD, by the way, at the highs of the day almost, retesting the 122 area once again. 122.20 to 122.50, as I said, will be hard to crack though. And only if we do get a daily close above 122.50, I think we can start becoming more constructive. We're now actually breaking above the 122 area. Stelio, did we have any more worth mentioning statements from Draghi?
No, he did say that FX volatility has decreased, but it was not discussed in the meeting. So that's all he said about...
I do see one more dovish, indirectly dovish message. ECB's Draghi says, didn't discuss monetary policy per se. Obviously, this is being interpreted as a dovish message from the market simply because, you know, when everybody expects for you to start becoming more hawkish and start, tightening monetary policy, if you say that you haven't discussed it per se, it means that you don't feel that you're getting close to the point of tightening monetary policy. So I think that this statement has dovish implications for the market, and probably that's why we've been seeing this last pop at 122.10. Other words used in discussion were patience, prudence, persistence, says Draghi. So yeah, that's also indirectly quite, you know, more of a hawkish message than the market expected. Okay, so let's have a look at a few questions, and then Stelio, we have your friend. What is your friend going to speak about in the interview, by the way? What's the main focus?
Actually, I don't know, but he's okay. I'm sure he's going to talk about the kind of analysis that he's done. He's more of a macro guy, a bit like me. But anyway, we'll let him talk about all that. So I don't Absolutely. Know exactly what he's going to talk about, but I'm sure he's going to be
By the way, cable already showing an outside white candle on the daily chart. You can see it here. So I think that today's daily close, if it gets confirmed, if we get a daily close above 139.80 roughly, I think it's going to confirm that a rebound has begun for the cable. As I said, levels towards 141, 141.80, and 142.40. Since the move lower that we saw had some nice momentum, I would expect that the chances of seeing one more leg to the downside are quite high, even if we are to remain constructive in the medium term. So I think looking for resistance areas to produce failures is the prudent approach in the near term.
I think the critical part of today's webinar, pat myself on the back, was seeing the divergence and the non-confirmation in euro, so that people that were short euro had the opportunity to cover, and aggressive traders could have either bought the euro or bought euro pound to have a successful day. I think that was really the key moment, and now I think it's baked in.
Yeah, absolutely. I totally agree with you.
So congratulate me.
Brian, congratulations, Coach. Right. We all know that you have an instinct for the market. Still in my 10-day trial and...
Favorite days.
We have a friend here saying, still in my 10-day trial and not yet subscribed, but feels like you guys could post more active patterns in play. Surely there are patterns in play not being published for whatever reason, but I'd like to see them shared more if I'm going to subscribe. Thanks, I've loved my time with you guys so far. And I have to answer to Brian that yesterday, I mean, completely coincidental, yesterday, I was monitoring at the statistics of our patterns in play, which, you know, anybody that has subscribed even for a trial can see, you know, that we've had a great performance so far. The company has been live since July 2016. So roughly, let's say 22 months, roughly. And within 22 months, we've posted 420 patterns in play. That is more or less 20 patterns in play per month. I don't consider 20 patterns in play per month few of them. I don't know what you think, Coach Sancelio, but personally, I consider it, you know, quite a high number of patterns in play.
Yeah, what I would add is that the way we pick them is we try to... We try to look at things that have a high probability and exactly. You know, the ones that we feel most confident about. You know, you can look at markets all day long and find 100 ideas, but exactly. Really only one or two are going to be the ones that really tick all the boxes.
It's what we were talking about yesterday.
Here's my thoughts, yeah. Dave. We're here to help you succeed, not make your brokers rich. And after I start talking to Carl in a minute or so, and Carl's a successful trader running a fund, he has 6 to 12 ideas a year. So that would make us look like action junkies.
That is very true. And as we were discussing also coincidentally yesterday in the chat room as well, the more you increase the number, the quantity of trades, the less, the more you decrease the quality of the trades. Because to get more trades in place, you need to reduce your criteria, your filtering out criteria for jumping into a trade. So that definitely means that, you know, the quality of your signals, in quotes, put the word signals, is definitely going to increase. And that's something we wouldn't want to do, right? So I think 20 patterns in play on average per month is quite a health number. That's what I think.
You know, Steve, the other solution for someone like that, and he probably doesn't recognize it, is that there are a multitude of trading ideas and scalping
in the chat room,
the private chat room.
That is very true. That is very true.
More activity.
Actually, Brian just replied and he said, "I've only been here 10 days. He didn't know the average." So anyway, stick around and you'll see.
And Brian, don't forget that if you go to the closed patterns in play, you can always look at the history of the patterns in play, so you can get a better idea of the frequency, etc.
Anyway,
the statistics are also there. Okay, thank you very much, guys, and we'll keep monitoring. Of course, we're going to be in the chat room because today might prove to be an interesting day. We haven't seen much volatility yet, but you never know. Sometimes an hour or a couple of hours ago, after option expiration, for example, we might see the market moving once again. Enjoy the interview. I'm going to be listening in.
Okay, Steve, nice job, you and Stelios, on the coverage of Draghi and interjecting all the commentary of his press conference. Thank you very much, you guys.
Thank you, Dale. And hello, Carl.
I'm going to pass the baton to you now, Carl. Looking forward to speaking with you and meeting you. Your buddy's here to give you moral support.
And make fun of him, too.
And have a good time. We're going to have some fun here, Carl.
We can hear you. Hello, Carl.
Oh, Yasu Stelios. How are you, my friends?
Hello, mate. Very good. Very good to hear you, man. Very good.
Dale, nice to speak with you.
Nice to meet you, Carl. Any friend of Stelios has a high recommendation in my view, and I want to thank you for your time today, for coming
speak
to us. Yeah. And
so I was just interested listening to you guys talk about the frequency of your ideas and the frequency of mine. And it's something that I battle with often because I try to keep so few ideas and try to only talk about or write about the ones that have really high conviction for me. I often make a lot of, type one error when you, believe in or rather reject a false positive. And so, there's a spectrum of type one and type two error, and, finding your place along that is kind of trying to work out your personality in this business.
Jack Schwager said that, Carl. I asked him, what's the most important advice you could give to a trader? And he said, find a trading style that suits your personality. So it takes time to get there. So I've coached people who thought they wanted to be a day trader, and after pulling their hair out and mental exhaustion for a few weeks, they go, well, I'm thinking about swing trading now. So, I'd like to take you back. I went to your website, nice website that you're building right now, reflexmacro.com, and I read a little bit about your history. But you know what I'd like to know, Carl, is how did you get into the business in the first place? What was your initial experience? What was it like for you at the beginning of this journey?
It was a kind of roundabout way, if you will, because straight out of school, all I was really interested in doing was playing rugby and you know, other things that young lads are interested in doing. And so perhaps a little bit distracted, but I think it was 2006, I picked up The Alchemy of Finance. And at the time I'd been buying some resource stocks, and at the time Western Australia was going through quite a boom with respect to the commodity super cycle, which it was kind of dubbed at the time.
Okay.
And then I realized that I knew absolutely nothing about this business, so I kind of took a step back and literally took all my spare cash, if you will, and bought every book that I thought would give me some idea about how to perform in macro, if you will.
Okay, name a few.
Oh, it's a long list. On my site, actually, Reflexive Macro is a reading list that I've put up. But
okay,
I would say the ones that are most influential to me now aren't necessarily trading books per se.
Okay, you mean like Livermore's book, and more about psychology, and you know, being in the zone is one that people like, and
trading in the zone is very good, and I'll definitely recommend that to anyone.
So it's really not our method; it's what's in our head.
Well, that's a part of it, isn't it? So it's
big part.
Kind of. I started writing this long essay. I tend to write long essays, so forgive me if this is a little bit off track, but I started writing an essay about how most of risk in trading is actually solipsism. I don't know if you know the term, but solipsism is defined as like being overly concerned with one's own kind of internal fears and turmoil. And as a trader, it's kind of precise to the manner in which a lot of us make errors in this business, because generally we're second-guessing our idea, we're not calibrated between the idea and our time frame, we're stopping out too soon, and then we get back in, and then we question that again because price goes against us, and so that's exactly the word for the kind of process of risk as a trader.
Yeah, it's magnified. What happens in our personal lives are magnified with leverage.
Exactly. That's the other thing. Dial it up another couple of notches and you watch out.
All right, Carl. Well, you know, you said that you stay focused and you have a few themes, so you know you write a narrative. So I'm curious what themes and narratives you're sharing with your institutional clients here. I know that's who you provide your service for right now. I believe you're developing this website to also service retail people, you know, little guys like me. So what are the narratives that have changed or that are still in place for this year, which kind of we had a little bit of a shift where equities were a very smooth, calm, one-way market, grinding, becoming parabolic, and then we finally had it crack, and now it's a two-sided market. So what are your narratives that you're communicating to your people now?
I think I was kind of lamenting a little bit earlier on Twitter today about the fact that there's been like a decline in the old school vision macro, and there's no real novel ideas at the moment, which is a little bit annoying and sad. But there are some quite phenomenal and unusual things happening in markets right now. If you look at the swap spread between the Aussie and the US dollar, you know, the two-year swap spread, or the same in the Kiwi, which is, you know, effectively the perfect proxy for the interest rate differential, the Aussie and the Kiwi are now negatively carrying for the second time in 30 years. I think the last time was in the Aussie was 90, 97 until Q1 2001.
Oh, okay, so that 97 year kind of rings a bell with me. Isn't that when we had the Malaysian ringgit or some type of Asian currency crisis in 97?
Yeah, so it perhaps follows that there's some type of cyclical implications here too. You know, I don't want to ring the bell on the market or anything. I don't have that kind of foresight, if you will. However, it is something that happened late cycle last time. It is certainly not the early cycle now. And so one must wonder. And so what also follows from this observation is that I think the Aussie dollar structure, well, mechanistically even is probably the correct word, because if you're anyone that's running a reasonable size of capital, you're going to really question whether you're going to get a reasonable rate of return holding any Aussie assets or Kiwi assets when you could just buy, you know, 10 years yielding 3% as they, you know.
Okay, so it's a competition from the 10-year note here in the U.S. And could it also be, I don't know if it's a chicken or the egg, but we've been looking at some long-term weekly charts in the Aussie and monthly, and, you know, the recovery that it's had over the last 6 months or a year, trends, that trend seems to be breaking, and it really looks pretty ugly here.
Yes, so my weekly trend following model in the Aussie had stops at 76 handle and 50. So yeah, we've broken through that this week. And presumably there's, you know, a reasonable argument to suggest that a lot of people will be turning around in the currency.
Let me ask you this. You think it's because, you know, people are hoping there isn't going to be a trade war between China and the U.S. and Australia really being affected by what happens in the Chinese economy, especially for demand of what brought you into the business, natural resources, and that could be part of the problem with Aussie, because it looks like it could, you know, maybe one day even trade down towards the move that we had here.
Yeah, that's absolutely the kind of second order thing that one must worry about. But also domestically, you know, I think things are tightening up in the property market here. And so, you know, the spillover effects could be magnified quite tremendously.
So you have a housing bubble in Australia?
I don't know, but I've been concerned about that for quite some time.
Okay, well, we've lived through one here. I don't know if 08, 09 was the same thing in Australia, but your cousins in New Zealand have put restrictions on people coming there. And the reason is housing shortage and outpricing, squeezing the citizens of New Zealand on affordability.
Well, it's certainly a more sensible policy, isn't it? Because Canada and Australia have made the mistake of trying to encourage the speculation in really what should be a consumer good, but instead, you know, perhaps it's a fallacy of economics to think that there's some type of trickle-down effect from, you know, everyone trading the same asset to each other for a higher price.
Well, that's what's been happening with central banks creating TINA. There is no alternative to stocks for, you know, we're talking about 9 years now. 9 years.
You'll have to forgive my ignorance. What is TINA?
There is no alternative, which, you know, forced people to take risk because they were getting 0.5% as a saver. So they, to get returns, they pushed them out on the risk curve, thinking that a bull market in stocks would have create a wealth effect in the country. And it did for the 1%.
Yeah. Yeah, that's quite interesting. And so, I don't know, I really wonder about this with respect to democracy as well. You know, why politicians are kind of encouraging people to do this instead of saying, hey, housing's a consumer good, take your hard-earned capital and put it into something entrepreneurial that will give everyone a return rather than you know, like a real return rather than.
So let me ask you this, Carl. Sometimes it's okay to not know what to do, and cash is a position too. And yes. I'm just sensing that perhaps right now with what's going on, and you're talking about, you know, the unusual nature of the carry and so forth, that things are unclear. And when they're unclear, do you recommend people just hold cash and wait for the clouds to clear up?
I definitely wouldn't hold Aussie, but I'm definitely on the flip side of that coin, if you will. I'm okay. Certainly no bear. I think expansionary fiscal policy in the US is much needed. Even though it is late cycle, we must consider that the US institutions are phenomenal in contrast to many of the other countries in the world, you know, that the dollar is relatively priced against.
Okay. So you would favor the long side of the dollar and dollar-denominated assets still?
Yeah, I don't think we need to panic about U.S. equities yet. I know it's a little bit of an oxymoron to say a healthy drawdown, but let's be honest, this business is people buying things and selling them, and occasionally we get bouts of selling and that's, you know, that's a part of the process. Unless there's some type of systemic kind of, mechanism.
Carl, how are you positioned in these markets nowadays?
Long dollar yen, short Aussie, the small gold short, which is kind of my home, if you will.
What are you looking? Do you have when you have like a gold short on? Do you have targets and objectives on the downside for a target? Is this a kind of a long-term thesis with a weak Aussie? I kind of correlate gold at times with Aussie. That gold, are you looking for, say, 1290, 1220? What do you have in mind?
It's really just a You could call a stop in a way like a defeasibility, like a point at which your argument could be proven wrong.
Okay.
And so the point at which my argument for being short gold would be proven wrong would be like perhaps another two quarters of high CPI readings, and so perhaps some relatively reasonable inflation signal there.
How about managing risk on that position? How do you do that?
Well, there's quite a natural stop at the highs at the moment. So
okay, got it. 1368 or something like that.
Yeah. So size small, stop at the high, and let it ride, and try to be correct. Well, I mean, there's no guarantee, of course.
Okay, so tell me on your setup what the green and red lines are.
Oh, are you looking at my screen at present? Okay, so I've just got my trend following model up.
Okay.
And this is basically just a proxy I use for understanding where trend followers are currently positioned.
Okay.
So it's not something I trade off, but rather a way to understand where stops are. So if I flick to the daily.
Is that some type of Bollinger band, the shaded gray area?
Oh, yeah, that's a Bolly. Okay. So it kind of just lets me know when something that is roughly at statistical extremes on, you know, okay. 20-day look back, if you will.
Okay. And what do you have a view on silver? You know, a lot of people are talking about, maybe you have a view on this, the gold silver ratio.
Yeah,
which, you know, historically is pretty extreme, and then we had that big squeeze move last week and everyone thought it was going to turn the gold silver ratio. So far that hasn't been confirmed. You have a
view? I just I just flicked over to silver first. I think this is really interesting because typically when I get these blue bars, which are compression signals on silver, we tend to have a large move. And, you know, these periods where it trades sideways and all the, you know, short gamma guys hedging very aggressively, you know, on these expansions, they tend to have like a sharp move and then a reversal. So whilst this was not as aggressive as I anticipated, it certainly was something to take note of. With respect to silver gold ratio, let me see if I can pull this up.
You follow that?
Yeah, I do look at it. I believe that Adam Robinson, is it Adam Robinson or Adam Robertson, is quite a sharp guy, pointed this out as a brilliant method to compare to yields. Oh no, that's copper gold.
Dr. Copper.
But let's flip over to that. Oh, never mind. This is too hard for me to do right now.
Okay, buddy. You're doing fine. Oh, so there was that pop in the gold-silver ratio.
Right there. Yeah, I didn't look at it. I don't find it informs my trading too much unless there's like some type of meaningful breakout occurring or something. Or, in fact, if you've watched the things that I write about, I'm more interested in looking for statistical kind of extremes. If that makes sense.
Okay. Do you have any right now?
No.
Or your position express it?
The most interesting statistical extreme is probably probably the rate differential between Aussie and US, really. That's the thing that is most front of mind for me.
Okay. So we're at an extreme. You're looking for it. Could it become more extreme or regress to the mean?
Yeah, in the long term, it will regress to the mean, but I am of the view that it will become more extreme. So as I mentioned with Aussie property, I believe that the RBA is in a bit of a bind with respect to trying to
are they trying to let the air out of the housing if you don't call it bubble, at least shortage slowly? So
I don't know if they can, to be honest, because so if you know, if their mandates are to focus on financial stability, you know, the household balance sheet and inflation, the household balance sheet is going to win out at the moment because that is the most precarious situation of the lot. And that basically means their mandate is partly housing. And so the ability for them to hike whilst we have this bi-directional monetary policy is very, very constrained. I can't see how they could do anything but a very dovish hike maybe late in 2019 if things don't go bad, but they could go very, very bad.
Okay. All right, Carl. Well, do you want to show your new website and tell our audience the best way for them to contact you to follow your thought processes? And
Hit me up on Twitter, which is Prometheus AM, or reflexivemacro.com is my blog, and it's kind of
okay. So everyone can find Carl's website at www.reflexmacro.com and on Twitter at Prometheus AM. Why the handle Prometheus?
Well, it's probably because I'm a fellow Greek like Stelios.
Oh, okay. How did you end up in Australia?
Well, my yaya, who was from the north near Thessaloniki, she emigrated here after the Second World War, and my little family began.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it was interesting. Yeah. Go ahead.
Also, Prometheus is like the first revolutionary, if you will. He was the first guy to kind of thumb it up to the big guys and say, up yours.
Okay, you maverick.
Yeah, and that's...
Carol, you maverick.
Very much.
You kind of maverick.
Resonates with me.
well, the whole team and the community want to thank you for your time today, Carol. Thank you for
spending
some time with us and sharing your ideas and really talking about less is more, where you don't have to be in the market every half an hour to, you know, take advantage of financial conditions. So again, thank you, my trading warrior brother. And
thank you, Carl.
Celius, go ahead. You want to say,
I also wanted to say that Prometheus is the guy who brought fire from the gods to the people, right? So you are you're bringing fire to the people. That's good.
I mean, we'd have to eat things raw. So thank you for bringing fire to face today, Carl.
I'm about to fire up the barbecue, so you look out.
Have a great weekend, buddy.
Nice to meet you. Cheers. Thanks for your time.
Okay, buddy. Everyone, that was Carl Hobson Thomas. Thank you, everyone.
Adios, guys.
Thank you, everyone, from Investor.
Delios, I'll speak to you soon.
Okay, thank you, Carl. And wrap it up with TGIF. Good hunting the rest of the day. That's a wrap for us. And most of all, don't just count your pips, count your blessings. Should have picked up some pips on that turn in Euro. Aussie Kiwi heading down. Talk to everyone tomorrow. Adios. You're welcome.